Hello. Good evening. We're going to start now. It's a great pleasure to introduce Nader Ardalan. He's just initiated a three-year project on reconceiving the architecture of the Gulf region. The Air School supporting this, and tomorrow we're traveling to the Gulf region to start meetings with colleagues there. Nader Ardalan has had a very long career as an architect of 40 years. He started by studying at Carnegie Mellon, then at Harvard Graduate School of Design, where he also taught. He has taught since then at MIT and at Yale and at Tehran University. Until recently, he was vice president responsible for design of KEO, a large practice based at the Gulf. He was a founding member of the Aga Khan Award for Architecture. I could go on for a long time. And he's won many awards. So without any further introduction, please join me to welcome Nader Ardalan.
Well, good evening. Nice cold evening, nice warm room. So I'm gonna take off this coat and we'll get started. Seamus caught me writing last-minute ideas. Actually, I'll begin by saying what have been my most recent inspirations that I thought I'd bring to your consideration tonight. And I'll do that as soon as I thank Seamus and the AA for inviting me to speak here. And I perhaps want to say a bit more about why the AA in carrying out this research in the Gulf region. I spent the last 12 years in Kuwait and Dubai and Abu Dhabi, Iran, Saudi Arabia, Qatar, more or less dealing with office of architects and engineers that were grew to about 1,300 people. So it was an office that gathered many large projects. It gave an opportunity to look at what was going on in that region, which, as you know, because of the windfall in oil resources and income today, it's estimated that in the next 10 years, that region will probably spend about $1 trillion in new development. And already those of you who have been reading or have traveled to Dubai and have seen the works that are doing there, you already have a sense of a type of incredible scale. Now, I went to that region about 20 years ago, invited to be a jury member to select projects that were being designed for that area. And really, there was hardly anything of any great substance built there. Kuwait had been the forerunner of development, but the other countries, Dubai, very sleepy, Abu Dhabi hardly existing in large development, and Qatar, you know, 200,000 or 300,000 people, very quiet. And really, in the last 10 years, this development of Dubai has happened, and really in the last 3 or 4 years, it's the development that has occurred in the other Gulf countries. I noticed that there was a gap, and you know, coming through London to go to Boston, where my home is, the subway keeps saying to you, mind the gap. So I minded the gap, and I found that the gap was that out of all of this development, Very, very few. I could probably count it in two or three hands, you know, one finger, two fingers, of projects that were concerned with sustainable design in an area that has the highest radiant energy gain in the world, and where there is a unique culture. And yet, the buildings that were being built were totally based on models that I would say were hand-me-downs of Gordon Bunshaft and SOM and the other American works, mainly, from the 60s, and now stretched, twisted, transformed, but really the same product, the same energy-guzzling, carbon dioxide-producing, socially isolated system of building cities and buildings. So the opportunity came when I was made a fellow at Harvard to do a research, and I went to see some of my old patrons, and here I have to admit, you know, mea culpa, I had to be, as a commercial architect, involved with some of these, but I also will show you projects that dealt more seriously with sustainable design. But generally speaking, I went to the patrons who had commissioned us, and I self-confessed. But of course, the self-confession comes through the circumstance, as architects are always dealing with what the marketplace generally is asking to be performed. So in the 1970s, I was one of the leaders in doing the first solar energy city in Iran that was exhibited at MIT as an example of how to do sustainable design. And then in the 80s and 90s, really there was low oil prices, so this subject became moot. But now I think it's something that you can go to someone and say, have you thought of these? And I showed them some of the things I'm going to show you. And they said, gee, what can we do about this? And I said, well, you can sponsor a research. And so when this research came into being, the thought was, well, the older generation are set in their ways, so they're not going to change. They're making lots of dough doing what they're doing. The way to change is to go to the schools and speak to the faculty and the students in the schools in these countries. And there are 8 countries that border the Persian Gulf. And here I have to put parentheses, because politically the name Arabian Gulf and then the Gulf is always, you know, in the work. So I'm only using the Times Atlas definition of that region, since historically it has been known as the Persian Gulf. In any case, these 8 countries, beginning with Oman, UAE, Saudi Arabia, Bahrain, Qatar, Kuwait, Iraq, and Iran. And so here you have 60% or more of the energy resources of the world in this little necklace of countries, and particularly cities, and yet they're building unsustainable settlements. What does that say for the future of world resource that is still dependent on fossil fuels? So it's a very important area. And now, why the AA? I had the opportunity to speak about this research with a number of universities. And I asked 3 simple questions. I asked, who's interested in this subject? Who has a curriculum history that has dealt with the subject of sustainable design? And who's ready next year to have its principal investigator take on this research? And do you know that the AA was number A1 check in every one of these, whereas other universities, including some of my alma mater, excluding one, which is Carnegie Mellon, were really not interested in this subject. Can we believe this? So you people really are, I guess because you live in England, you live in the European environment in which this is very much the topic. And of course, yesterday in the newspapers, ta-da, there was all the disaster that has been produced by Sir Stephen's submission of his report. But so there's a lot of consciousness here. There's a lot of beautiful engineers here who are working on these subjects. And I've had the pleasure of working with a number of your leading engineers, and I'm working with them now. So this was the right place. And Simos, God love his soul, caught this spirit and has caught this spirit, has had this disease for, I know, 20, 30, so many years, ageless man. And I'm happy that we're going to journey tomorrow to the Gulf region, in which we're going to start really these kind of workshops and lectures. I think this is the beginning of a very important series of works. What is the intent of the work? The intent of the work is nothing less than revolution. I swear to you, I think that we really want to go there and see and explore what are the opportunities for sustainable design, for energy efficient, water conserving, environmentally friendly, culturally relevant design. And at the same time, when we explore, we want to find out what guidelines can we develop. And Simos is going to lead a lot of this research in the technical guidelines. But we wouldn't be actually very far, I think. We'd be partially fulfilled if we only dealt with the technical aspects of sustainable design. Because if we're going to do sustainable, we really have to build a sustainable society. And so this evening, I'm going to speak a little bit about these two things. Since being a student of Louis Kahn, God love his soul, there's the measurable, and then there's the unmeasurable. Yeah? So we're going to speak about the measurable and the unmeasurable aspects of this quest. And I could have maybe entitled this talk slightly different. I could have said the title might be The Creative Challenge of Multicultural Imagination. Because I think it is the world of creative imagination that's going to be the most important element in this research. So quickly, I've explained more or less this work. That's the way it's sort of set up. And the year one, we're going to study Kuwait and the UAE because they've sponsored this work. And we have the American University of Sharjah that has a wonderful school of architecture and design. And I'm happy to say that George Katadrayas, who is an AA graduate, will lead this work. He teaches the fifth year studio. And the Higher Colleges of Technology are really a group I mentioned to some of my friends here. They're sponsoring this really on behalf of the Minister of Higher Education. And they're a group that is actually trying to set up sustainable industries in the UAE. And their principal investigator is the Director of Policy and Planning. His name is Senthol Nathan. And Kuwait University, Dr. Adel Al-Momen, is a U.S. graduate in solar energy design, and he's going to be leading that work as their graduation project for their students. And then the Architectural Association, the illustrious, who sits here, Mr. Simos, and wonderful friends whom I've met who are going to be teaching. And I guess, would you help me, how many of you in this room will be partaking in this seminar and in the studio with Simos? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. Wow. Great. If I had asked this question of some other universities, there might be great silence. Know who you are. Know where you are. It's wonderful. You're leaders in something that I think will have wonderful resonance. And in time, we'll change the name architecture. I think it will probably become sustainable designers or something like that. Because you're very broad. I think architecture originally, you know, architecture originally had a beautiful meaning. And if we go to that, it's all right. Architecture, oh, it comes from this guy. Yeah, from the Greek, yeah. What does it mean? Archi, to archetype, to the original, to the primordial. Okay, archi. And then tekti, carpenter, tek. And ur, process. The process of making archetypes. Wow. If we go back to that, then all right, you can be architects. But that's not where we are. We're not building architects. We're building icons, so-called. And we're catching images. And the images are really like perfume bottles. They have very interesting perfume odors, but essentially they're fading and ethereal. I think you need to build something more substantial than that. So. And we have some wonderful consultants. Some of them are like Helcro, who are marine consultants, because the Gulf, in the study that we're going to do, is not just the land, but it's the interface between water and land, what is called the intertidal zone. And I'll talk about the intertidal zone to you, because that's where all life of the Indian Ocean comes from. At the same time, to help us with this ecology, there's a wonderful ecologist in Kuwait, Dr. Ali Khurabit, a graduate from Edinburgh, and he and his wife are ecologists, and they're helping us, and other engineering groups. And these are all voluntary. Voluntary. People are devoting this time voluntary. I'm talking about the consultants. Now, I'll tell you later what I do in this. This is the Persian Gulf. Since 1979, a wonderful resource located in Kuwait called ROPME, R-O-P-M-E, has been documenting the Gulf, supported by the eight nations around this water body. Principally, it came about because of the oil industry, but we have wonderful records about the climate, the water temperature, the silting, the pollution of this area. So you have a lot of beautiful data. And I just show you because it's a beautiful, almost closed necklace. Yeah, there you have Oman, and you have the UAE, and then you have Qatar, you have little Bahrain, you have Saudi Arabia, you have Kuwait, Iraq, and you have Iran. And I want you to also notice, please, the topography. These are mountainous Zagros range that come tumbling down to the sea, and these are really flat areas. And if you were to look at the global warming, and if you were to be optimistic and say that there's only 1 meter of water rise in the next 100 years, about 25% of this zone would be completely wiped out. And if you deal with the 5% or the 5 degree temperature and the 5 meter rise in water, well, I can't imagine such a catastrophe. But this is the region that we're going to study. And the principal area that most people, of course, were interested in were all these little wiggles, because these are all the offshore drilling wells and pipelines that go back, and that's where you got that 60%. And then way down below this area between Qatar and Iran lies the second largest gas fields that exists in the world. So there is an enormous amount of tanker traffic that comes up and down the Gulf, and they flush out their tanks before they load up oil, and that's where this pollution begins. And then, of course, people are developing all around here, and they pollute the area. And unfortunately, you get the Shatt al-Arab and so much of the destruction that came that I'll show you with Saddam Hussein's invasion and then the burning of the oil fields, which these record. So you have a very delicate, beautiful, small body of water that has these kinds of things. Look at this beautiful. These are all the life zones that are around the, for instance, island of Bahrain. Mangroves, coral, and other vegetations, most of these now really endangered by the developments that are happening in this zone of Bahrain. And this is, of course, what we know most publicity about, which is Dubai. And these are man-made islands going out. This one's already built. This one's partially built and then stopped because this one, they found there were two things happening. Because this had no roots in anything related to marine environment, this palm, which you can see actually in a satellite photo, has water. And by the way, the movement of water in the Gulf is counterclockwise. And one of the aspects about that is the fact that it's very shallow, and so it takes 3 years for one drop of water that comes in from the Straits of Hormuz to move and come out. So it means the more you go up, the more silting there is, and so that means the more pollution there is. So up in the Kuwait zone, there's most pollution, and as you walk down to these areas where there's slightly deeper water and more wave action, there is less pollution, but there's more development, so that ain't something that will stay. But I just want to tell you a little gossip about this guy. In this thing, and all of you know about Bernoulli's principle, you know, limited opening, fluids move fast, and so this whole area is being washed away from the beaches, and then this area is all silting. And meanwhile, this whole thing is slowly sinking. Now, in the same time, they're building something called the world. So those little dots are actually man-made islands that replicate the 168 countries of the world. And you can buy, you know, you can buy America or whatever, or England. And then they stopped this one just to sort of try to, you know, do better marine engineering. And then there was this even huge more, you know. So there's a lot of things happening which are relatively unconscious. And the big area that you know is this strip, which is called Sheikh Zayed Road. And we'll see some pictures of that. Now, nobody wants to begrudge development. Nobody wants to say that some of these people really are not developing, I think, architecture that could interest people. However, it doesn't have a morality of sustainability in it. Okay, and so some people could say, so what? I have so much oil, my electric bills are subsidized, they're very cheap. Why should I even be concerned? Well, the reason you should be concerned is because all of this energy-guzzling development needs enormous resource because you have to essentially take oil, produce all of the turbine-generated electricity. You have to produce water by desalinizing from the ocean. And so all of this takes enormous energy. Can you imagine if you could do an infrastructure which is, for instance, half as much energy consumptive, how much longer society could last? Because, for instance, Dubai has no oil. It's just now on commercialism. Dubai is the replacement of Hong Kong. I mean, that is like the overall plan, if you can look at it. Hong Kong existed for about 90 years, and it was a very substantial, interesting commercial development. And now this new development in the last 10 years really is Dubai. And it's a global development place. It's not really something that you could say belongs to the Arab world, okay? Because, for instance, in Dubai, the population is 5% nationals, 95% what, when we worked there, we were called expatriates. You know, so I would say that when you're looking here, 50% of the population who are here are Indian workmen. Then there's goes to the population of, I would say, Indian subcontinent workers. And then it is Filipino, and then, you know, some from the Arab countries, Egypt and Iraq and others. And maybe our smattering small percentage, maybe 10% of Western, Westerners. So a certain amount of Iranians, because the greatest, God bless you, trading partner between Dubai and Iran. I mean, Iran is the largest trading partner of Dubai. So their cultures are very linked. So you're looking at a huge global city being developed with global interests and financing. And so it's a very nice, interesting, new, unique creation that is coming into being. And we'll talk about that a little bit more. So you now have a little smattering of what's there now. Well, this is something from the time of the Elamites. That's approximately the time that, and Sumerians. It's like 3000 BC. So this business of trade between this zone and Iraq, which was the Babylon of old, has a long history. And this documents essentially forestry that was being cut from this area being brought back to Iraq during the time of the Babylonian-type empire. And so you have a very long history of people. And this history is very important. And because of the fact that they lived by the sea, they were really shipbuilders. And this continued subsequent to the Islamic transformation in the 7th century. And you have really a history of boating people, of merchants, of pearl divers, of pirates. And fishing, wonderful fish that come from the Gulf, the greasy grouper, you know, wonderful names that they have. They have sharks, they have dolphins. I mean, it's very beautiful, and yet all of this is being polluted. So in the northern Gulf, people are stopping to eat the fish because of this reason. Here's an image of the Iranian side of the Gulf. Look at these unbelievable sensuous forms coming down, and then look at the people, and then we're going to look closely at these women. Oh, they're really incredible, beautiful, beautiful people, a very traditional people that really, I would say, when I went there in the 80s, many live this way in both sides. And on the right-hand side, you have images from Oman, and you might take a look at these beautiful carved door. And this carving really came because much of the carvers of and wood trade came from India. And so you get a tremendous Indian sensuousness that mixes with the Islamic period of history. And so you gray. And this same detail is on this guy's beautiful scabbard there. So you get this kind of condition on both sides of the Gulf. Yet these people have been transformed. Many of them have been transformed in one generation. But their towns in Oman are very beautiful. Oman has not yet changed so much. And so this is this beautiful white architecture, wind towers going down into the Gulf. And then this is on the other side of the Gulf in a place called Bandar Lange in Iran. Courtyard architecture, great wind towers, people living on the roof. These little walls here are to protect and create privacy when you sleep here in the summertime. And really a compact, environmentally adapted, traditional city of the Gulf region. And these all have now been transformed. And this is the tallest building in the world. It's a 200-story SOM building. It's now already finished up to this level in its concrete structure. And then these are all the other developments. And what you may be familiar with, actually, is between this zone and here. These are the Emirate Towers, and this is the Sheikh Zayed Road. This is all the new development. And this new development is now being exported to other countries and to other cities in that region. Why? Because it's very successful. People have made billions of dollars off of this. And so we go to these people and we say, what are you doing when you're doing, for instance, this guy or that guy or this guy or this guy? And they say, well, we're building an iconic image that's not yet built. And we say to them, well, what about building an iconic image that's sustainable that has not yet been built? And they said, oh, you mean there is such a thing? We said, yes, and we're going to do research on this. So we want to research and explore and develop guidelines and test on an academic level for the time being sustainable models for new urban development, for architecture, and for the components of the architecture of this place. I love it, the sabromat. In Persian, you say, you know, when a sneeze comes, you say, don't go too fast. So, then somebody has to give a second sneeze, and then you can proceed. There used to be a king, Safiyan knows. Oh, thank you. There used to be a famous Persian king who, if someone sneezed, he would stop whatever plans he had, and he would not proceed until the time that a second sneeze came, and then it was all right. So this is not superstitious. I really don't think we're superstitious people. I don't think we're peddling new stuff. That is, you know, another thing, another carpetbagger. I think those of us who are working in this field have been working in this field for 30, 40 years. It's just now, I think, the time to act. And there's a lot of support for it. And there's a lot of technology. And the interesting thing is that I find in the woodwork of all my friends from the 70s who we did work with, well, one of them started a wonderful laboratory at Carnegie Mellon called the Intelligent Workplace. And she's going to get involved with us in time, Vivian Loftness. And she used to be dean at CMU. And there is a couple of others. And quite obviously, I don't know all the actors in Europe, but Simos will guide us to many of these people. In any case, I want to say this is then what needs to be reconceived. What I think needs to be reconceived is that there are no working models for developers who must act fast that's sustainable, that people can use. So what are we waiting for? Let's get to work. That's what needs to be reconceived. And of course, I'm not going to go through this stuff because you all know this, right? The environmental crisis. How many have seen, for instance, Al Gore's An Inconvenient Truth, the movie? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I suggest, Simos, you must get this movie for everybody to see. It's a beautiful movie that's like a slideshow that shows this environmental crisis so clearly that, you know, it will convince the unconvinced rather rapidly. In any case, I've already gone through the 1 meter rise in water temperature, the coastline settlements of 25%. In the past 50 years, the world has lost 25% of its topsoil, 30% of forest cover. At the present destructive rate, world will lose 70% of its coral reefs. What's so important about coral reefs? Well, for God's sake, that's where all the breeding ground of the sea life occurs. And, you know, so who needs sea life? Well, you know, keep it on going. I saw a wonderful show at the Tate Modern called Flowers and Questions. Have you guys seen that? It's a wonderful Swiss mad people who do things that turn, you know, bing, bop, bing, this leads to this, this leads to this, this leads to this. It's very beautiful. It's actually on a DVD you can get and watch how you can look at cause and effect. Very, very simply, very nicely, very funny, humorously, creatively done. And that's the problem here, that this kind of environmental crisis that we're going is cause and effect, and yet there's like quadruple effects that we can't even predict as to what would be happening. In any case, the number six, the Gulf marine environment is eroding drastically due to slow three-year flushing, oil tankers, offshore drilling, pollution, mangrove, coral reef destruction, urban development, and geopolitical conflicts. Yeah? So this is the crisis. And as we know, we architects and planners, we have a role to play. Why? Well, we're told that, for instance, in the United States, energy consumption and CO2 emission by sectors, 40-80% comes through buildings. Are you architects? Is that what, that's who we're supposed to be doing? Are we planners? Well, transportation. Let's say industry, the bad boy, will take care of itself. 75% of this stuff comes from us, things we could contribute to. New urban planning that has mixed use, less transportation, more efficient use of land, more efficient use of human energy, and buildings that are more efficient. How? Well, we have another AA graduate, dear Ken Yang, who uses this diagram. And it says, life cycle energy costs of building stuff, you all know. Yeah, we are, when you build a building, you pay that much of the triangle in roughly a 25-year cost cycle of a building. The rest goes into maintenance and operating costs. If you could cut operating costs by being efficient by 30%, and I'll show you, we did one project in that way. My goodness, what could you save people? How could you save, you know, in terms of emission, et cetera? So there is real cause, there's real science in our method. And Ken goes on to talk about energy consumption of building operational systems. The little diagram says, you know, those little crumblies, as Charles Correa used to call those little crumbly traditional buildings I showed. Well, they operate by passive natural ventilation and passive design. They use this much energy. And those buildings I was showing you in Dubai, you know, the 200-floor one, they use this and more. So mix use. Instead of going to full air conditioning, how can you do some things that have some mechanical assistance? And most of the time, you may, for instance, be able to get by with better insulation and less energy. 4 months out of the year, that part of the world is really beautiful weather. We're going to take CMOS to nice weather in Kuwait and Dubai. And really, you can open the window and, you know, you go in shirt sleeves. You don't need to, there's not that much heat. But people haven't thought that way. And so these are the things that we will explore. Now, the illustrious American Institute of Architects, who's not known for being, you know, the philanthropist of architectural societies, they have come out just this year. The AIA recognizes a growing body of evidence that demonstrate that current planning, design, construction, and real estate practice contribute to patterns of resource consumption that seriously jeopardize the future of the Earth's population. Wow. That means everything we're doing is wrong. Furthermore, they say the AIA's board of directors set a good beginning in 2006 by slashing fossil fuel consumption of buildings by 50%. Ho, ho. Long live the AIA, in 4 years, and express strong support. Listen, this is stuff. Why? This is stuff that means that those of you who are getting into this research will have a job when you come out, because this will be a selling hotcake in 5 years' time or 3 years' time. You're at the cutting edge of something wonderful. Forget the money. Think morality. Think of what you have to do. And that's where I want to go on my next set. So we say, how can you become the leader of sustainable built environments in this region to our friends in the Gulf region? And we show them, this is Kuwait in 1950. Okay, in 1950. Now, what is this? Today is 2006. That means in 56 years. Now, generally, generations are 25 years. My wife tells me they're 10. But if you take three generations, so from your grandfather to your father to you, they have changed from this to now. What's interesting is Kuwait, for some many reasons, has not yet followed Dubai. But it has in the drawing boards about $500 billion worth of buildings that's going to imitate what you saw in Dubai, but they haven't built it yet. So it's very important timing in which you say, my God, here you had a sustainable society, a sustainable culture, and sustainable buildings. True, you had to survive in 35 to 40 degree heat, and that was your comfort zone because outside was 50, 55 degrees centigrade heat. And so you reduce it by 10 or 15 degrees. But nevertheless, you had a pattern. You had a whole pattern. All of this pattern was wiped out in 1960 and 70 because this was considered backward, and you had to be modern. Okay, so I'm going to diverge now because I've presented stuff you all know. I want to talk with you a bit about some things that might be now dealing with the left hand, right? We dealt up to this time with the measurable stuff. Let's talk a little bit about the unmeasurable stuff. They say that from death comes rebirth. This is a tradition in many societies. In the society in which the Gulf exists, there's a long history of something called fana baqa, that is death and rebirth. This kind of idea, I was looking for what examples of death and rebirth have we had in the last 100 years around the world that we could latch onto artistically. We're creative artists. One of the criticisms about sustainable design, and I hate to say this in front of my friend Simos, is that it's ugly. Well, how can you make it beautiful? Well, people thought about the ugliness of World War I, the destruction of World War I. And what came out of it were some beautiful movements. So I'm going to speak a little bit about one of the movements that I think might be a point of inspiration for some thinking, and perhaps it is already in your minds. I think the Dada movement, I think the Surrealist movement of manifested in the 1924 manifesto written by André Breton, in which Arp, Miro, the whole slew of people, and associated with this came Kandinsky and Picasso, and you know, the whole movement to look at the destruction and death that came after World War I, and to think completely new, to think nothing material, because you saw such material devastation, there must be something better than this material world. The world of the abstract came into being. And this idea of the world of the abstract, expressed in the artistry that is right now shown at the Tate Modern so beautifully, deals with the idea of the individual dealing with his or her own understanding of the reason of my existence. And it was helped a lot by the fact that around the same time, Freud came up with the theories of the unconscious. And so the theories of the unconscious, the theories of dreams, the theories of the relationship between dreams and reality, between the idea of reason and intuition, and the dealing with intuition, your intuition, your DNA genetically coded personal intuition about why am I here? What is the story all about? This can't be it, because it led to such horrors, World War I. It can't be it. It can't be the reason. It's not a beautiful reason. So the Surrealists were looking for an elegant, poetic reason of existence, and they expressed it in the works that we marvel at. And then, of course, subsequent to this, it got transformed, and you had other movements, and you will always have other movements. But somehow this Surrealist seed, the abstract, exists now as a major theme, and a person like Pollock picks it up in the 40s, and still the strata runs through Stella and others. So I want to first of you take aesthetically to the abstract art. Okay, now, what does abstract art have to do with this Islamic world that we're dealing with, or this part of the world that's principally culturally in that milieu? Aha. In the East, you have had always a tradition, very long, pre-Islamic, the theory of the East, which dealt with, and you found it in Siddhartha sitting under a Bodhi tree, or you find it in the Zen Buddhist monk raking in a Rwanji garden. Yeah? The idea of the personal mystical quest. And I don't want to go into this in a religious way. I want to go into this as a spiritual way. So I want to ask this spiritual riddle in this research of ours. What's the spiritual quest that can take us into sustainable design? And I want to, in this part of the world, bring your attention to a very beautiful philosophy, very beautiful attitude to life, which may be a help. It's not the total answer, but when you're looking in a research, you look at clues. One of the clues is the process of thought and worldview called Sufism. I don't know how many of you are familiar with this term, but it's become rather popular. So, for instance, in America, one of the hottest selling poetry is of Jalaluddin Rumi, the 12th century mystic, who called Maulana. Yeah? I give you a piece of his poetry? Okay, I will. A princess sat at the threshold of her room in a garden, deep in meditation, mystical. Another asked, oh, why do you not look out into the beauty that God has created in the Garden of Paradise? To which she answered, the beauty I hold within, without, are only the signs of the symbolic and the true beauty that lies within me. This is a beauty and a thought process that in 1970, Lu Khan came to Iran in Esfahan in a conference, quoted this poem to us. Lu Khan was a mystical architect. I'm not trying to tell you that Lu Khan is the answer to things, but I'm trying to help each other to say that don't think of this attitude as only a Eastern attitude. Don't think of this only as a odd Islamic attitude. No. What's the quest? What's the quest? What's the connection? What's the possible connection? The beauty of our research in the Gulf lies in the fact that there's a global society building these societies. I said to you, Dubai is 5% nationals. That means you've got a multicultural nation building something. So the question that lies at the root of this quest is, what's sui generis to Homo sapiens as common aesthetic, moral, spiritual principles that we share as common ground in which each of you, and look at this wonderful multinational culture in this room, what is that multicultural creative imagination place that we must seek, we can seek in ourselves and with one another, that then we could develop theories of design that, on the measurable hand, are all the things that science teaches us. And then on the left hand, all the aesthetic principles that are also needed. And I look at spirituality as an aesthetic principle. And the interesting thing about now surrealism is that André Breton and the others thought of this spiritual quest as an elegant idea that they were after. They were after an elegant idea. So I ask for a certain elegance in the work that we seek with one another. And when we put these two together, when we put this unmeasurable and measurable together, I believe then you can truly deal with the idea of death and rebirth. Now, I think that I've got to stop. So I've spoken for about an hour. And I could go on, but maybe we do that in the workshop that we're going to have with each other. And well, I think normally the protocol is those who want to leave can leave right now, and those who wish to stay, and if we can talk a bit more, but. You're very kind. Well, now, I would say, you know, all stories have, these are Scheherazade stories, you know. They have highs and they have lows. From now on, it'll go a little bit lower. But in any case, we'll go on. Because I do want to talk with you about something else. I think if we only dealt with the idea of technology, which is sustainable design, and then the idea of this sort of anthropological, cultural, aesthetic, yeah, we would still not be at what is being asked of us, because our patrons, our sponsors say, we want you to give us guidelines to be able to put into municipality regulations to then be able to implement sustainable urban development. So we've got to now deal with another aspect, which is, what is the lifestyle that is needed to support a sustainable environment? Aha, it's a big setup. Ta-da! So I won't go into this. This is the type of stuff that we're doing. We're sort of groping in the dark, but we have wonderful bright lights such as Simos and others who will help us. And this is these little red dots are the developments, the urban development centers around the Gulf. And you'll notice that there are more red, bigger around this side than that side. And really, you have only major two developments here, Bandar Bushehr and Bandar Abbas in Iran. Iraq almost has no developments on the coast because it's really Basra inland there. This is Kuwait, and I'm going to then sort of go into this zone. And so the first year of work will look at Kuwait. This is Kuwait City. It's about 1 million people and growing to around 3-something million people. And in that growth, a new city will be developed here in an area called Subia, and some kind of a causeway is proposed to connect it. There is already a sort of a Bedouin town called Jahra, and then on the Saudi border, there's something called Kairan, maybe another 200,000-300,000 population. But in time, and already, the development is very linear all around the coast, and it's about 180 kilometers from here to there. It takes about 2 hours in a good Mercedes-Benz to drive this zone. And so really, it's just a handkerchief. It's just a necklace. It's just another one of the part of the necklaces. It's maybe a bracelet of this place. And so that is an area of our study. And I think, you know, I don't know. I don't think you can come and study this zone and not do regional study. But then people will say, my God, wait a minute. We're just architects or sustainable design. How can I deal with, you know, regional sustainability? The answer is, if you don't deal with it at a regional level, really, I believe we're lost. Because it's at the regional level that a lot of the major decisions about where people live, where resources are, where you work, that kind of thing happens in any case. Similarly, the image that I showed you of Dubai, well, Dubai starts really upland here in Ajman and even a little bit up further in a place called Ras Al Khaimah. And the university that we're working with is here in Sharjah. And Dubai is here. And it's growing. It's already grown linearly and down to Abu Dhabi. And so that's another 180 kilometers. Interesting, almost exactly the same, 180 kilometers, about 2 hours drive. And in time, quite obviously, this will be one great linear mega city. And so you have to think in our way of thinking, you know, I mean, who said we have to stop thinking, you know, just 5 years down the line? I mean, think, I don't know, 50 years down the line. It doesn't make any difference. But think big, because you have nothing to lose, because you could come up with some very interesting suggestions. And because we're an academic environment, because the work is an academic one, you're free. It's you're offering to the world your beautiful mind. So I think those who want to stretch it out, think regional. And those who want to go to the particular, think particular. Together, complementing one another, I think we can deal with this. I believe one person or two people in a team can come up with beautiful ideas about regional ideas for this place that probably would astound a lot of the decision makers who are thinking in very small boxes, because that's the way that business is. You don't think 5 years down the line. You think tomorrow. You think my bottom line, that's going to happen at my quarter that's ending in, I don't know, day after tomorrow. So think outside that box. This is a wonderful book that I strongly recommend to all of you, and I think some of you know it, called Natural Capitalism by Hawken and Lovins. And I love this word. Lovins is a Mr. and Mrs. Job. So there are two here, there's a couple. And they run the Rocky Mountain Institute in Colorado as a research center. And Hawken, I think, is here in Europe. Anyway, they deal with what I think is a very interesting book to deal with. And this deals with societal revolution, of how you can go from what today we live in is industrial capitalism to natural capitalism. And this may be another one of these clues. And I strongly recommend it. And it has like four principles. One, it says radical resource productivity. So factor 10, to achieve a tenfold increase in efficiency of energy usage and natural resources. Now, do you all know that today in our production systems, we are like 20% efficient? You know, like for instance, when you produce electricity in turbines and things, 25% efficient, 75% goes out the flue. Why is this not caught and made into a total energy system? Because we don't think that way, because our industrial systems are not set up that way. So how to make more and more and better use of our energy, because right now we use very little bit. And why do we use very little bit? That's a moral problem. The problem is we look at nature as a zero cost. You have trees in Brazil, you use it. You have stones here, you use it. You have X, you use it and you throw it away. You put no value on the cost of the resource. This is one of the big problems, and the main item, first of all, is to get higher levels of efficiency. And I think that's something that we must also work on. What does it mean to us as architects? We'll discover. The next one is biomimicry. All of you know the Velcro came from that little thistles, and so you imitated a thistle and you got a new, yeah? Biomimicry, how to imitate nature and survive in harmony with its mode of operation. This is a beautiful, this is both dimensions, left and right hand. Right hand, you learn about the fact that nature has no waste. Have you ever seen waste? No. This thing falls, that guy eats it, he creates this, you know, the cycle keeps going round and round, no waste. So that's the measurable. But then, follow and survive in harmony with operations, mode of operation, that's also internal, that's also very personal. That's a personal life thing. How can you live like nature? Not like Tarzan necessarily, but how can you live in a much more natural mode? So I took off my coat, you know, that kind of stuff. You live just simply by, you know, and when I visit Simos's studio up there, you know, you open the window. So the next one is service and flow economy. I think this is the key that'll be probably tested by many, many people. It says a shift from an industrial economy of disposable goods, the refrigerator that you use, the TV you use and you throw out, and it becomes junk, to a radical increase in resource productivity and economy of constant recycling and flow of services. So this idea is that you go into the business of just recycling. So nobody's out of a job. Everybody is producing this. And you know, in many of our countries, there's still that guy who comes around with a bag and he says, old clothes for, you know, sale, or do you, you know, these things are, and I want to just tell you, in my own lifetime, having lived from ages of 6 or 7 in America and in Iran, it's amazing the shift that happened in America from post-war America and the 50s to suddenly the 80s and 90s in America. Sudden incredible change of energy consumption. You know, as we know, the United States has a little bit less than 5%, 4.5% of the world's population, and yet we use 30% of the world's energy and actually produce the highest levels of CO2 production, etc. But this wasn't the case. So I'm saying in this Gulf region, you saw that woman with this red Zorro mask on. That was just one generation ago. So if they changed to building 200 floor buildings in one generation, they can change to go back to another way of life. So it's change is very important. Doesn't mean that you go back to the same way of living. It means that change is possible. It means that radical change that you went through already to go from this is also possible to yet another mode of survival, because survival in this global warming is the key to the message. And as you know, science has a very simple rule. Very simple, very simple, very simple. You adapt to survive. You migrate to survive, or you go into extinction. So global warming says, 200 million people will have to migrate from, you know, and already that's happening. That's where all these wars in Africa are happening. So these are things that are happening. And so consequently, these are real facts of life that I think we have to deal with. And finally, this says investing in nature, restocking world natural systems to save the biosphere and human existence. And this has to do with, you know, this business of carbon dioxide controls and et cetera. And these are all terrible, tedious, but they will go into law, or else we will go into extinction, or we'll go into crisis. So anyway, read this book, this good book. And you know all these things, right? So we're going to study in the sustainable design. We're going to do the bioclimatic zones of the Gulf region. There are at least two significant bioclimatic zones and some subsets. So it's not all hot and wet. No, Kuwait, I'm telling Simos that he has to come with a sweater because it'll be a little colder. But when he goes to Abu Dhabi, he has to take the sweater off, put on short sleeves, see if it'll be humid and relatively warm. Ecological systems, land and water, very important that we understand this. Impact on global warming about what we're doing there. Environmental sustainability of coastal settlements. Really, that's the key. I think if we could say something about how to build, maybe we deal with floating cities and on all that kind of level. And so all these things, adaptive urban form, mixed-use development, landscape urbanism, we have to deal with the idea of transportation, total energy systems, and governance. And I think that you know these very well. These are LEED, or if you go to all the British systems. But this is the area, design innovations and energy aesthetics. What we do should be really something beautiful. And of course, beauty is the eye of the beholder and et cetera. But Aristotle said, beauty is that which points toward the good. So we're going to do, in the fall term, we're going to essentially deal with the development of criteria. And then we're going to do in the spring term, we're going to do regional urban design innovation studies, and then into architectural design innovation, just as studies in this work. Well, I think that this is something that I just want to say about what I personally believe in. For the last 30-some years, I really have experienced these little triangles. I was a student of Mies van der Rohe and the other gangs in the 1950s and 60s. And really, we learned that architecture was really basically form follows function, and you needed to know the technology to create that form. That's all we were taught. You didn't have to bother with anything else. In fact, the modern movement really wanted to do away with any cultural hints because they were like excess baggage, and unfortunately, very little attention to the environment. You really would overcome the environment. So I remember asking Mies van der Rohe, because at the time he was teaching us, he had designed the Berlin National Gallery. You remember this big space frame? Yeah, this universal space, yeah, that's. And then at the same time, he designed exactly the same building for the Bacardi Rum building in Cuba. One in concrete, one in steel, but exactly the same building. We say, but hey, how could it be? He said, because it is universal space. And so we learned about universal space. An elegant man, beautiful theory. This was our teacher. I don't mean to deride this elegant man. These were wonderful. These were masters of our age. But I want you to forget all those. And then in the 80s, you know, with the movement of postmodernism, others, culture came in. And I guess quite a few years before that, I went back to Iran in 1964 as a, you know, American-Iranian, 18 years out of the country, never been back. And I was shocked. I couldn't understand, you know, why did they do these domes and buildings and brick and tile? And so I had a cultural identity crisis as to who I was as an architect, and obviously also as a person. So I did a lot of research, and University of Chicago at that time asked if I would publish a book, and I published this book. But again, I went after it with a camera and a yardstick, and I still couldn't understand because I was only dealing with my right hand. And fortunately, in the 1970s, late 60s, Iran, which has been classically xenophobic, that is always closed, very little in its history that it ever opened up. But in the 60s and 70s, this great ancient culture opened up, and you had the world minds who came and studied Iranian literature. So Henri Corbin, the great traditional investigator of Islamic mysticism. Toshihiko Izutsu, a Zen Buddhist teacher, 14 languages, wrote a book comparing Lao Tse and Ibn Arabi, that is, Lao Tse and Confucian thinking with Sufism, and many, many, many others. And we were all kids. We were your age, more or less, studying with these people. And so this left-hand side of this cultural aspect of life and design, and I produced a book in collaboration called The Sense of Unity, the Sufi Tradition in Persian Architecture. And from those times in the 60s and 70s, I got involved with building with the cultural aspect. And I think that that has stayed with me and is very important. In the late 70s, we got more involved with the environment. And a wonderful man by the name of Ian McHarg, who wrote this great book called Design with Nature, that I strongly recommend with all of you who you know, I worked with him, he worked with me. We did a number of cities in the south of that country. And so I found in my life that these four forces of design, if I paid attention to these four forces and I was true to them, and I could continually look at them as riddles because I didn't know enough about them, but they were my koans, they were my spiritual koans. You know, the Japanese have the spiritual koan. You have to ask a question. And then normally your master, once you give the answer, he says no. You do wrong. But it's good. It's good because it keeps you thinking. So I want to say that with this I want to end. And I want to thank you all for allowing me to come in your presence. And I say, my God, the challenge is right in front of us. If we have the energy, we have the will, and we seek our creative soul, I think that we may come up in the next year, and then in the following year, and the other year, some wonderful solutions. But you are taking the first steps. Others will follow your footsteps. Adios.
Is it working? Yeah. I've sort of got half a question, half an answer, because taking the inspiration from your from presentation, and I think I just want to draw a sort of a semi-parallel issue with something that I experienced about 2.5 weeks ago in Denmark, and the notion of dealing with resources, like you mentioned, the states around the Persian Gulf, they've got all this wealth of resources, they've got an amazing cultural tradition and the knowledge, and yet we're sort of semi-blindly adopted, let's call it, without being too politically sensitive, more of a US model. And what is happening is that even within Europe, where there's a focus on this whole issue of energy conservation and the environmental issues, even here we are doing this more out of, some of us may do it more out of on a moral basis or need, but it's not really forced enough on us. And what is interesting, they're saying that if you start looking in China and India, in particular China, the situation is reaching a point whereby they're going into this, not because necessarily they want to, but it's the need. It's, as you said, you adapt or you go down, basically. Their whole economy has grown to tremendous levels. And they are basically saying that they have no choice but to go to sustainable design. And the whole debate started coming that there may even be that it's the China that will show the world how to do sustainable design on a large scale, as opposed to Europe or the US, but drawing the know-how from the Europe or the US, and then applying that. And the application will take a very different route, not so much a consultative route, lots of big debates, 5 years or 10 years in discussion what we should build here, but rather top-down management and saying we are going to do this for 2, 3, 4 million population cities in one go. If this is kind of developing, and you obviously introducing this academic research in the Persian Gulf, this is where the question statement comes. How do you see that as a parallel activity to what might be happening further far east, in the sense, do you think that the population there eventually can say, well, it's happening over in China, you can see over there, or are you saying because it's a very different cultural background, you're approaching this in a different way? If you understand, I'm trying to sort of...
It's a good question. There's this thing happening,
and they're doing it because maybe they'll make other mistakes, but they'll just go ahead and do something. And here we're approaching something very much more solid in terms of three-year research base.
Yeah.
But maybe there's something to... How can one draw these parallel strands?
First of all, any research is going to have to rely on the body of knowledge that it gathers. So, Simos, how much knowledge of Chinese sustainable design do we have? The second aspect, I would say, in a way, this is legislative top-down, you say. Yeah?
They're coming here and they're speaking to all different municipalities.
Oh, I understand. But I think...
taking this message back home, maybe paying some European or American architects who they believe offer interesting solutions. And what I found interesting, they're actually trying different solutions in different cities. So...
This is good. This is...
This is good.
The
most from our mistakes anyway.
Yeah.
And then they're just going to implement things. Just see where it's taking them. What I find interesting, it's almost doing your exploratory work.
Good.
But thank God. But they're not going through it in a process of... I don't understand how they go through the process of evaluation in terms of COVID academic evaluation, which is maybe the most appropriate for their company.
Well, I mean... Middle East, big pyramid, somebody sits on top, everybody does, But I think that if I go to my surrealist model for you, one of the dictums, maxim of the surrealist movement was that poetry is not exclusive to one person. Poetry must be practiced by everyone. It's really important because if there is not a societal belief in it, it'll be a big, big struggle. But it probably is a combination. And I think that another aspect of it is these regions that we're dealing with have very small populations. And so it may be possible to make a very significant change. On the other side of the Gulf, in Iran, is very interesting. Iran is following a model very similar to China. It has a 70 million population. It deals very closely with China. And it's a totally self-sufficient society, but unfortunately in a rather mediocre way, okay? So it produces everything, and its energy consumption, et cetera, is relatively lower. Its pollution is much higher. But it's a country that definitely practices, simply because it's a larger population, this So where's the beginning of this research? You're raising very good points that our research coordinator, I'm sure, has noted and will follow that. Thank you. Is there another question?
I think something maybe to add might be useful for your research. One of the bodies that we also deal with is called the Futures Group.
Yes.
In this particular work.
Yes, and yes.
There's three or four organizations in the world. This one is one in Copenhagen. And what is great is the participation of them. Their whole work is about, well, what is the future?
Yes, yes.
Unprepared for another vision, which is also, well, which is probably more inspiring because it combines all these aspects. But they were, you know, they were just moving in the direction they thought was the right one, and then all of a sudden, there's a presentation, inspiring, technically feasible, economically attractive, and all that. But it's a different vision, and doesn't this?
No, actually, to be honest with you. I said that principally this is an academic activity, but there are already a number of client types who have said, what could be the distillate of this research? And if you actually take a piece of land and you demonstrate your work with the students on specific projects on land, and it has something that we can measure and grasp, and it looks tangible, we're willing to build, test sustainable communities. So, no, I think it's just the right time.
Any more comments, questions?
There seem to be comments, questions here. That fine gentleman. No. Is there anyone? Fine. Yes, in the back.
My voice is down at the moment. So it's a very cheeky question. Have you seen REM's version of the analysis of the Middle East recently at Venice Biennale?
Yes, REM is holding something called the Design Initiative, and I've been asked to contribute to the publication that is coming out of that. So it'll be, different views.
As in good views or not so good? I mean, specifically, my view is that he doesn't talk any or relate at all to anything else apart from architecture, meaning he doesn't think about spiritual or other things like that, although I think he's the...
Chacon a son goût.
He's the greatest architect in the world. But how do you convert...
6.3 billion people in the world? He's one of the gifted explorers. Let him explore. No? Let them explore, and let us explore. I really feel that this is very important because there'll be many, many people who will peddle sustainable because it's so easy. Because first of all, it's intangible. You don't know how to measure it yet. So, fine. We're also lost in our way. You know, I mean, we have some ideas, and we've been doing some explorations for a number of years in it. But obviously, if we had a product that was already there, then we wouldn't, we wouldn't need so much research. No, we're just at the cutting edge of something that right now we know pieces of it, and it's a puzzle. And I think if we're broad enough, by the way, we're holding a seminar at Harvard in December to which AA will participate, and we have anthropologists, economists, governance persons, Islamic scholars, sustainable designers, and other people who are coming, and we'll see. You know, this is.
Can I just please leave you with a comment then before I?
Sure.
I think as a practitioner, I think the tactic should be that you convert people like him, because sadly, the followers of people like him are here. This is what happens. You know, I'm one of his followers, And unless you convert somebody like him, it won't happen.
Every revolution has a struggle. Every hill has to be climbed. He's already a master of his own way. So let him go his way. He's a great gifted master in his way. It may not be the right answer that we're seeking. We will seek a different answer, I'm sure. But I can learn from him. Very open. No mind. Blank slate. No mind. But some principles by which to gather the parts to solve the riddle. That's where I am, at least personally. And I found Simos to be very open. I find the people that we're working with at the universities really looking for a lot of leadership in that part of the world without a lot of answers already. So I find it very fertile ground. And I think that the works that I see coming out of the AA certainly has enough abstractness in it to meet my criteria of some surrealism. What I like to do, though, is because I see the students, because I'm on the schools of these different colleges, okay? So I go to the American University of Sharjah and I see, the same wiggles that I saw here at the AA over there. And then when you really sort of pull it apart after its beauty, I'm always surprised that there's not much content there. You can't build it. It's not sustainable. It's not functional, but it's very beautiful. And so, no, if the beauty is a sign toward the good, it's a sign toward something. No, it's a sign toward something. We're all struggling. Nobody has the right answer, or else we'd be doing it. No, nobody has the right answer. We just have to have principle. That's the right answer. You need some principles. Okay. Thank you. Okay.
Thanks again.
Thank you very much.